Hi, my name is Fraser Simons. I'm going to be reviewing Michael R. Fletcher's Beyond Redemption, a Canadian novel, which I like, as I am Canadian. This is a dark fantasy book in which there are individuals who I can't pronounce the name of, Geisteskranken, maybe, who are able to manifest their delusions, self-delusions about themselves, become reality in the world, depending on how many people they can convince to believe in what they believe as well. They have like an external and internal power. The internal one is something small that is a catalyst for them, and then the external stuff comes from the power of belief of everybody else in the world. It's a literalization of how faith kind of works in our world. The more popular something is in the cultural consciousness, the more synonymous it becomes with being truth as well, even though it may not be empirical truth or what we would define as actual reality. It's easy for ideas to sweep us up in this reality as well. It's just in this one, it's fantasy, and there's sort of archetypical powers of individuals come from this self-delusion, which we are told is always a self-destructive force. By the end of it, these Geist and Kraken people always end up being destroyed by the self-delusions that they have. So right away, it's a recipe for dark fantasy, and it's pretty interesting and unique concept as far as I'm aware. I'm not super well read, I guess, on fantasy, but I don't know of another thing that does this, and it does it pretty well. The only problems I have with it is it tries to be a little bit too edgy with the ideas in a commercial fiction-y kind of way, where it dumbs down the significance of these delusions, especially mental illness, fat phobia. It's still very much fantasy, generic tropisms that are just not reflective of actual reality and used as punchlines or as edginess to entertain people. The characters are generally unlikable. The more that you get to know them, the more likable they become because you understand them, but they're never morally good. They're not even morally gray. They're always morally bad, basically. And they all have separate powers. One is a swordsman who is convinced he's the best swordsman in the world, but the only way he's able to do that is by convincing everybody that he is, which is fun. So anytime he goes to a new town or to a new city, he seeks out the greatest swordsman, and then he does a sort of stage play or performance to convince the people in the crowd that he's the greater swordsman, and then by doing that and including them in his delusion, he does become the greatest swordsman. And so it goes. Every time he goes to a new town, he eventually could become the greatest swordsman in the world, just because everybody else believes it, and he believes it of himself too. He treats women poorly, he treats his companions poorly, one of whom is a woman. The other male in the party is an older guy who's scarred up and missing two fingers. He's an old swordsman, but he's got more of a tactical mind and he's the brains of the operation. He doesn't have powers like the swordsman has. He just has tactics, pragmatism. He's a coward when it comes down to things, and he's just looking to get paid, basically. The other two characters have of no real significance to him. The last character is what's called a kleptic. And she's basically a thief archetype who people can't really perceive in their peripheral and stuff like that. She just disappears. She is constantly stealing her companion's money. She's characterized as being unattractive, and she is a killer. She'll basically just kill anybody that gets in her way. So there's a lot of moments where she's sort of the archetypical backstabbing thief person. The crux of the story comes into play when there is a massively delusional person with a lot of powers, and they have taken on multiple delusions, so multiple powers. They can do a bunch of different things, and it comes to light that they are cultivating a unique individual. They are trying to create him as a god that overtakes all the other gods in this world. And by doing so, he will be then able to rule the world because he controls that god that he created. Part of the delusion that he has is that he has managed to cultivate this young boy as a one of the only individuals that is unaware of how terrible he is and how terrible the world is, and they're only feeding him information about insofar as it would create the perfect world for himself and themselves, this new religion that he is the head of. So it's an interesting plot. It's an interesting setup. The most interesting thing for me about it was the world building and the concept. I just didn't think that the execution was that great, because it ends up just recreating the same power structures that we see in our world. So as different as you think it would be, it isn't, and it's still very much painting the mentally ill and the marginalized people in this reality as still poorly, even though you would think that the people without agency who suffer the most, who have to cope with the world by becoming delusional in some ways, would garner agency. That agency ultimately ends up corrupting them and twisting them into these disgusting creatures. Sometimes it centers a lot on grotesque natures, manipulation. There's basically no such thing as consent in this world. There's lots of showing people as disgusting, as being fat, and being take advantage of people in sexual ways. There's sexual assault for sure. So what could have become a very interesting concept ends up becoming just kind of a mediocre book for me. I gave it 3 stars. I wasn't interested in anything beyond the concept. Even the characters kind of grated on me because all of their flaws are continually hit upon every single chapter. We understand the dynamics between the three, yet it is constantly reiterated and reiterated, so that when the things that they say they will do, which you would think would be unbelievable, even though it's in character for what we know of them, when it finally happens, I think it's still supposed to be surprising that they're going to do those things, but it's not, because I took them at their word. They were kind of pieces of shit, and they acted like pieces of shit, and I didn't really care about that so much. The interesting thing is that they had some agency in the plot. I thought the plot would be driving things much more because of the interplay between agency and the way the world works, but the characters did make some decisions that definitely altered the plot somewhat, but I think it would have ended up at the same place regardless. One of the powers is to see the future too, so it kind of takes away some agency. Yeah, he only sees some snippets of things, but you know what is going to happen based on the snapshots that he gets, and those things do happen, so it's not even subverted in an interesting way with that particular power and in a way that it could have been. So if you like the concept, I would say still check out the book. Just don't expect... it's a pretty thriller-paced book in which every 3 or 4 pages is a chapter for the most part. It switches POVs a lot. the villains are very villainous, twist the mustache type villains, very over the top, but I think it makes more sense because we know they're actually delusional and whatnot, and that's part of their power, but also their downfall. But I would say if you had to like compare it to something, it would be like still watching an action film with just like a bit of an interesting concept. It doesn't subvert the genre, I would say, but it is still a good time, and it's worth a read if you're interested in dark fantasy. 3 out of 5 stars isn't bad for me. It's still a good book. I would probably recommend it with the caveats that I mentioned. So that is Beyond Redemption, Michael Fletcher, a Canadian author, and I will see you next time.